entirety, even putting weird cards like Dreadsteed in it as well. How do you like evaluate Reno Warlock's power in the current meta?
I think it's quite a powerful deck. It's sometimes it's considered not to be tier one because it you can only run one Hellfire, one Shadow Flame, and against some of the more aggressive decks in ranked play, it can struggle at times. Demon Rot, yeah, it's an additional AoE, but quite often it's not strong enough to get that full clear that you need.
I do want to follow up and ask, do you like all those Kazan Mystics and other small things thrown into it? Because it does reduce its power level because it's inconsistent with all these tech cards. But do you like seeing all these things in tournament play?
If you are to bring those type of cards, I do think that tournament is the time to do it. Because you have a strategy going in. You know what you're going to be banning. You don't need to play tech cards that are good against the class that you're about to ban. You might realize a weakness of, okay, like, let's say, Freeze Mage. I'm going to struggle with Freeze Mage. So
yeah, that's a good
point. Definitely do like bringing those cards in tournament play more than in the ranked play.
Now, speaking of tech cards, Sky High has two of the strongest ones for this matchup. Hellfire, not necessarily a tech card, but very important against Patron, being able to deal with a flooded board from Snail. But this Acidic Ooze has the potential to get value here. And a lot of players would just slam Acidic Ooze in that scenario, but Sky High recognizes it's just 3 damage. It's not really going to kill any relevant minions of mine. I should just save that Acidic Ooze to deal with a timely Deathbite.
Mm-hmm.
Patron Warrior is a deck that's very reliant on Deathbite. You really want to set that up. Use it to have a big swing turn with Grim Patron or Battle Rage, something like that. So being able to take that off when it's on one charge can be game-winning.
Yeah, I think that's a really smart play to keep that Ooze for now. It seems convenient there. You have 2 mana available. Just play it on curve. Get an early minion out. But I do agree that it's much, much, much more important for the Deathbite.
I have a question about the swing with the Fiery War Axe on turn 2. What is he trying to do by putting the health lower? He knows what kind of deck this is also because he saw the Warlock from yesterday. What is he trying to accomplish by swinging to the face so aggressively like that?
Well, he wants to make sure that if he does draw Deathbite on turn 4 that he can swing with it right away. So he wants to use these Fiery War Axe charges before then. And he knows that a lot of the early minions coming out of the Warlock are going to be things like Imp Gang Boss or Dark Peddler. So it's unlikely that he's going to have 2 minions that he can kill with that War Axe, especially when Sky High knows he has the War Axe, right? You know, he's less likely to play minions into it.
Yeah, personally, I really like this type of approach to the matchup. The longer the game goes, the more it favors the Warlock player, from my experience, because those AoE cards are just more likely to be there for the patrons, and taking an aggressive stance early on might allow the Warrior player to end the game before the Warlock starts playing those big threats.
Yeah, he's got almost every AoE outside of Shadow Flame. Even the Twisting Nether, a card that you don't expect to be the big game changer. But sometimes when Patron Warrior is still able to build a big board, they have cards like Dr. Boom and Pilot Shredder in. Sometimes Twisting Nether still gets the job done, even though it's not the prettiest. Oh, it is very pretty, though. Twisting Nether is really pretty. Sometimes I get tempted to take it on a date and hold its hand.
It's one of the coolest animations in the game, that's for sure. Snail here going to go in for 2 damage instead of taking out the Acidic Ooze. And that there aren't many ways to get punished other than Defender of Argus, which, or Abusive Sergeant. But yeah, Sky High does have that Defender here. He's really just trying to avoid letting Snail take a turn with 2 patrons alive, because that's when Patron can do some crazy things. A couple of whirlwinds. That's a million damage.
I absolutely agree with this Defender of Argus play here. Snail getting a little bit punished there for being greedy and trying to get those two extra damage points to the face. Might have been worried about the Mortal Coil. He does know that his opponent is playing a Reno Jackson deck, so there is only Defender of Argus, so it might have also been a calculated risk and not necessarily like a mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. Now he's trying to figure out what's the most efficient way to deal with this board. He's got a Slam Whirlwind play lined up that is going to get rid of Whirlwind for any future patrons that he might draw.
Yeah, but I mean, you gotta go for it.
Yeah,
got to double execute those minions.
It does conveniently set up the Frothing Berserker to, just for one turn, live what it's like to be big game. It gets shut down pretty easily. It's going to be at 8 attack.
Yeah.
You could even double inner rage here for some extra points.
Go all in.
Yeah, I don't know if I like that play so early on.
Sky High's got Frothing Berserker in his sights, and I think we're just going to see a life tap outside of that.
Yeah, life that big game hunter seems pretty good. Hellfire is certainly something that you want to save for later on.
I guess you do feel very comfortable squeezing the life tap. It's not like 6 mana is capable of pushing out 11 damage very easily. It's usually a setup of other things, like a Deathbite. There are some decks with Patron that have bursts. Some people have been putting Khorkhan Elites in that deck so that they could pressure a lot more throughout different phases of the game. I don't think we saw that through Snail, though. A lot of them choose to switch in cards like Dread Corsair, the Pirate that has Taunt, or even Loot Hoarders, for example, like Crane from the EU region likes doing that.
Yeah, there's a few different variations, but I can't quite remember a Snail playing any of those Gorkrones. And even if there was a Gorkrone, it doesn't add up to 11,
sure.
Even with a weapon or some inner rage. And Big Game Hunter, easy decision. Can't blame him if he chooses to skip the tap here, because his hand does look quite powerful. So why take unnecessary risks?
Yeah, Snail's definitely unhappy to see two executes in his opening hand. It's a card that is fantastic against things like Handlock, but in a matchup like Reno, a lot of the early mains that they play, aside from Twilight Drake, aren't really worth executing.
Oh, Armor Smith, not exactly what he hoped to find there. He needs some extra guard, or maybe a battle rate, some extra minions. Those execute, don't do anything right now.
Yeah, Snail's considering using another Inner Rage right now to cycle, but he recognizes that that makes Acolyte of Pain vulnerable to Mortal Coil. But yeah, his hand is looking pretty rough. I would not be too surprised to see him run that out there.
It feels really bad to use the last Inner Rage like that because of their potential patrons, but the hand is just so poor right now. I wouldn't have blamed him for that if he did choose to play the Inner Rage.
Yeah, one of the awkward things about Battle Rage here is even if he does draw it, his life total is still at 30, so not going to get as much value out of it as he wants.
That's a good point. The fact that the Patient Warrior is often using a lot of its cards to combine its, you know, make some combos and try to flood the board, they need to refill their hand, and Battle Rage is so key to that. We've seen so many Patient decks just fizzle out, similar to like a Priest in a way. A Priest has a lot of combo cards, but without the card draw, it really doesn't have a lot of answers or even pressure to win the game.
I don't pick all. I think that's an excellent choice. Kind of like from the weak play from Snail, High figures out that Snail's hand sucks and just... Also the Owl, it's not really worth keeping for later on in this particular matchup.
Yeah, not too many things to use that on aside from Acolyte. So at this point, Snail really desperately looking for Deathbite. He needs to draw like a Deathbite into a Battle Rage and then make a big patron Battle Rage turn. And that's something that could get him back into this game. But right now, he's just debating, okay, do I let everything live? Do I maybe use an Inner Rage to take out a BGH?
It's true. The nice thing is that Reno Warlock, these days still have a very slow approach to the board. They're not putting in huge damage to end the game unless it's specifically like an Arcane Golem version, and I don't think it is. When you see cards like Refreshment Vendor and whatnot, it usually includes more defensive cards from Sky High.
Absolutely. I like this play. Just armoring up here, saving all of his good stuff, hoping to maybe pick up a Whirlwind Effect or Deathbite would most likely be the best card he can hope for, just to set up that patron for the following turn.
It's starting to get pretty high pressure, though. That's 15 damage on the board. Oh, I like this.
That's Sky High. God.
He chose not to attack with that Big Game Hunter, so that way he doesn't put Snail below 30 health and potentially give him Battle Rage to draw more cards into something that gets him an out.
Very heads-up play.
I don't know. I think that's a little bit like too fancy for my taste.
Too fancy?
Because he's going to have to put his opponent down to below 30 anyway soon, so missing 4 damage just to... Yeah, I don't know, but let's see. I mean, there could have been a battle rage, so it's not like strictly a mistake.
I think the way that Sky High sees it is that either way, he doesn't kill him the following turn with that 4 damage, and he'd rather deny that card. And I mean, but I do agree, it is a little fancy. He did hold his pinky out on the mouse when he was clicking it for that attack. But I mean, in this case, I think Snail doesn't really have a choice either way. He has to go all in. This is what his hand's dictating.
Yeah.
But there's going to be bad news waiting on the other side when Al Sky High shuts this down.
Yeah. This all-in is getting called by that Hellfire, and Snail gonna only have that Armor Smith afterwards. It's almost an impossible situation for Snail after this turn.
Yeah, Armor Smith's a tough lady, but I don't think she can hold off the fear of Jiraxxus coming down next turn, which is almost certainly the case if Sky High feels pretty confident to do so.
Yep, Sky High is gonna drop pretty low running that Hellfire out, but there's no way Snail can really punish it. There's no...
Oh, that's fine too. I think that's completely fine. Saving the Hellfire for later on. Hellfire does have that lower mana cost, so in the future turns when you choose to go for the Hellfire, you can also play some other cards on the same turn.
Yeah, it also gives him more life to play with, and even if he did play Hellfire, what else would he do there?
So. Exactly, yeah.
I guess the only thing you could do is life tap, and I'm not sure if you feel secure about that. Now that the board actually has been reasonable size with the Sludge Belcher, choose to go for the Peddler. Take a really safe approach. Completely unnecessary to try and go super all-in aggressive. right now, time is on Sky High's side.
Yeah, Snail needed a Battle Rage here. That would allow him to draw three cards. If he got Battle Rage into another Battle Rage, something like that, maybe there was still some hope, but Unstable Ghoul, that's not what he wanted to see.
It's interesting because in the recent times leading up to this tournament, Patron Warrior was on the rise. You know, if it was a stock market, it was definitely the hot buy because it was great against a lot of the Paladin decks. It's pretty strong against Druid these days, and you know, those are two of the more common decks you see. Even Zoo, it still has a pretty reasonable matchup. So you saw Patron Warrior starting to get a lot of high placings on ladder, and even people are talking up against it. But one matchup it does still struggle with to this day is a defensive Warlock deck like Reno, which happens to be a bad matchup for Snail in this first game.
Absolutely. Those board clears are just so efficient. The slow Warlock decks, the defensive Warlock decks, like you mentioned, have probably the strongest AoE in the entire game in form of those Hellfire, Shadowflame, and Twisting Nether. Sky High drawing all three. The old Patron was so powerful with the charge effects, because those cards didn't matter as much, because you could just like kill your opponent in one turn. But nowadays, just can't do it anymore.
Look at Sky High, he's cracking his knuckles, he's moving around. He's feeling so comfortable because he knows there's nothing he can do. Snail is roping out because he is out of answers and out of luck at this point. He doesn't have anything to do. I mean, the pass here is completely justified. What else could he have done here, Raynad?
Snail, I don't know if he was considering Unstable Ghoul or if he's just letting it all sink in. I think there's no reason for Snail to concede right now. He doesn't have to show any more cards, and he can just kind of find out more about Sky High's decks, I suppose, maybe if they play against each other later in the tournament. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's not much he can do from this position to turn it into a winning situation, for sure.
Not at all.
Well, I guess never say never. There are these small, weird opportunities to maybe have one card that can flip the matchup. But I agree. I think it's like one of these things where some players have a never surrender attitude. You never give up, never surrender. And I really like that because in the game like Hearthstone, sometimes it's really never over till it's over.
Yeah, I also like having that kind of approach, because if you are somebody who makes those like early concedes, maybe there's a time where it wasn't quite the time for that, and you kind of get drawn into a line where it's just like, if things look bad, you concede. And with so much on the line, if this was ranked play, Snail probably would have found the button in the bottom right corner, but with so much on the line. Oh, no, it's two deaths, but that would have been best card
it's time
earlier.
To dual wield, as far as I'm concerned. Grab both of them and just start hammering. But it's also one of those things, too, is like Sky High can start being aggressive even as soon as next turn. Now Jaraxxus is behind a taunt. Now he does have some reasonable-sized minions, and he doesn't really have anything else to do here.
It is worth pointing out that maybe if Snail draws a Grommash and just goes in with it, there's not much on Sky High's board to interact with it.
Like, imagine a slam here. He could just remove the slime, go face with the weapon, then top deck a Grom, but no.
It's true. And, you know, Snail's getting reasonable-sized minions, and now Sky High doesn't really have anything but AoE.
I don't know. Maybe there is some hope.
Yeah, he plays the weapon.
Like, that board is not strong at all from Sky High, and Snail does heal for 5 because of the Zombie Chow.
Yeah, Sky High did draw all of his reactive cards, so his hand doesn't really do too much unless Snail's playing minions.
Sky High has been skipping a lot of the potential life taps playing defensive, so that might be hurting him a little bit here. Let's see. Oh, well, that's a good card. So now he can easily life tap and heal for a full 16. Well, back to full with that brand Bronzebeard effect on the heal button.
Yeah, that is pretty absurd synergy. Right back up to 30.
There you go. Who needs Reno Jackson when you got Anti-Cubot for 15 effectively? That was ridiculous. Yeah. In this scenario, you get the Death Spite and you have the Grim Patron. Does he have the ability to come back? There's still big cards like Grommash, like Dr. Boom, which, like you said, doesn't exactly get answered. So it's still not over, really.
Snail could potentially pick up a Battle Rage. Draw close to the rest of his deck.
That's a huge draw. Harrison Jones shutting down the second Death Spite means that there's no longer anything else, and it also draws him a card deeper in his deck, allows him to pick up more useful tools.
He could have Demon Wrath maybe before playing the Harrison, but does want to go for those Imps. Well, so many Bowling effects are gone, so those Imps might do some work, and now he gets the Battle Rage.
That was the turn, right? It was the play the Patron, swing with the Death Spite, use the Battle Rage. into another Battle Rage. You would have had two more cards.
I don't believe it. Like, two Death Spites. Death Spite was the best card for very early on. Then it's like, okay, he really needs a Battle Rage, but the way he drew them was like, okay, when he didn't need the Death Spite anymore that much, he drew two in a row, and now when he can only draw one card, he draws two Battle Rages in a row.
Yeah, I would say it's a pretty tough matchup for Patron Warrior to begin with. But yeah, Snail's Draw is definitely not been going his way, and we're starting to see a lot of tech cards out of Sky High to really help him this matchup even more. Acidic Ooze and Harrison. This guy does not like weapons.
Like, Sky High definitely came prepared for this particular matchup with the deck. Those deck choices say a lot. Wow, he even skips a life up there.
Yeah, no needs for him to, I guess, get close to fatigue. Sky High takes game one very convincingly, even though it took a while. It wasn't really a threat to him at all. Seemed very composed. Like we were saying, he was leaning back in his chair, kind of like, you know, waving his arms, getting loose.
Yeah, I've seen control decks play out like that once in a while in tournament play, or just kind of going through the motions for the second half of the game. But Snail's definitely not out of it. Patron's a very strong deck. He can still beat almost anything with it. It's a deck where even your bad matchups aren't that bad, so.
Yeah, out of these matchups, I think that was the worst one for Patriots anyway. So maybe there was Sky High got a little bit of mind games going his way for the first pick because they don't know what class the other player is starting with. So he got a favorable matchup there, got an easy 1-0.
That's right. So that's game one in the books, one step closer for Sky High to be able to advance in the group. And it's one game closer to us revealing a new card. That's right. Today, we're going to be revealing Whispers of the Old Gods card here on stream. I don't know exactly when, so just stay tuned, but it's definitely going to be sooner than you think. I'm excited to see it because I just want to see more cards. That's ultimately what it's about. I mean, in the end, we like playing Hearthstone. Well, some of us like playing Hearthstone. Nah, we're just kidding. All of us love playing Hearthstone a lot here. And we're just looking forward to what's coming up on the broadcast. Make sure also while you're there waiting and watching along with us to vote for your players by hashtagging OwlSkyHigh and as well as Snail. Just let us know who you're rooting for on the social medias there. So in the meantime, let's take a look at our newcomer and the pride of Argentina, Snail, with a small little segment before we go into game number two.
My name is Santiago Yati. I'm known by Snail. I'm 25 years old, and I'm from Argentina. The esports scene is a lot smaller in Latin America, but it's growing really quickly. We're catching up. Argentinians are really like passionate about sports and even esports. In my case, I have to travel 2 hours to go compete in the LAN events, like the Father's Day gatherings and other tournaments. The connection where I live is not really that good, and that is a problem. For example, I can't stream. Like, I have the best connection possible there, and I have like 256 kbytes of upload. That's terrible. Yeah, I can do pretty much nothing. Being here is a dream. I never thought I would be here. I felt like I was the underdog in the qualifier, and I still feel like I'm the underdog here. When I was going to compete in the qualifier after winning the Torrent Hero, I was like, I don't know, just going to have fun, let's say. Torrent Heroes are supposed to be skill-wise lower than the other players. After the first day, I was really like proud of myself and like, maybe I can do this. I came this far, I can't stop now. Of course, nobody was expecting me to do that fine, not even myself. I beat a lot of amazing players that I used to admire, but I still do. Of course, the Argentina community was all happy, you know. I received a lot of messages from people from Chile, from Uruguay, from Brazil, and it was really nice to feel that support. Winning here would be my dream. It would push me to become a professional gamer, and that was always my dream, even from when I was little and I started to play video games. I'm the living proof that anyone can be here. Vamos, Argentina, carajo!
I love the passion coming out from Snail representing the Latin American community. I also like his shirt. Seems like he's a Jab boy. Having that Jab representation. Of course, people don't know, Jab is an America's finalist from last year's America's finals. So shout out to my boy Jab. Take a look at the series. Now that the Warlock's out of the way, was that expected or is that something that was definitely a curveball into the series of these?
The way that the decks lined up for game one, it was definitely expected for Sky High to take that one. the Warlock deck itself, I don't think it was like amazing amazing counter to entire lineup from Snail. Not at all, but that matchup was a very good one.
Yeah, he's got to be very happy to get that Warlock out of the way, maybe not have to play, you know, a Warlock deck with a Cidic Ooze and Harrison Jones against things like Tempo Mage. So, yeah, definitely important win to get out of the way, but still anyone's game, and we'll see how the decks line up from here on out, right? He's still got Egg Secret Paladin. He's got Tempo Mage for Snail. That might be the matchup we get here. It's interesting to see if Snail ends up picking Patron a second time, like a lot of players do in Conquest, or if he wants to switch it up.
Right, and it is relevant because there might be a good matchup, there might be a bad matchup waiting on the other end of it. Let's go into game number two, see what's in store. Snail stays on the Patron Warrior, while Sky High is going to queue up what looks to be that Egg Secret Paladin, which has been getting more traction. Tice, semi-finalist and European champion from 2015, he's been playing some Egg Paladin on his stream, and wrecking some nerds, so I'm definitely liking it the more I see it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really cool twist to the usual thing that you see without those eggs. Those eggs go really nicely with the buff effects from the Paladin, Blessing of Kings, Keeper of Uldaman. They can support the eggs extremely well.
Yeah, the bright side here for Snail is that he is playing the version of Warrior that has probably the best matchup against Secret Paladin lists. We see a lot of Control Warrior in this tournament, but that's not really a deck you want to play against a Secret Paladin that has like just an endless stream of effective threats. Whereas Patron Warrior can get a pretty big lead early in the game with Grim Patrons, and that's a board that Paladin has no way to come back from.
Yeah, the deck that Sky High is running does not include any equalities, and equality is a key card for clearing the Patron board from the Warrior player.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, if Snail has that early start with Death Spite and Inner Rage on that Grim Patron, sometimes the Paladin just loses right on the spot because you can't answer it and it gets out of control. The hero power of the Paladin feeds directly into the Grim Patron statistics. So it's very hard sometimes to stabilize from that point.
Absolutely. If Snail gets that Grim Patron flood on an early turn, it can be unstoppable for Sky High. But if, let's say, the Patron does not get drawn in time, in that case, Sky High might pull too far ahead.
Yeah, Sky High has found room for more tech cards, even in his Paladin deck, not just the Egg, but we see Iron Beak Owl. It's not something we usually see in the deck. But Snail's draw here, looking a lot stronger than Sky High's, right? Sky High really misses that one drop here that he wanted, you know, Secret Keeper or Zombie Chow in some cases. But Snail's just going to go two drop, Acolyte of Pain, and you know, just say, deal with it. It's such a strong board when you are able to establish that Acolyte behind a Ghoul.
Yeah. I mean, he could also play the Armorsmith, but I certainly would like to see the Ghoul here. Master for Battle is the most likely turn 3 coming up, and he has that Acolyte of Pain to follow up the Ghoul.
Interesting.
Yeah, it certainly is.
He pokes the Egg, which always makes me a little nervous, not only because I have Nightmares from the Raid, but also because the fact that the Egg comes out with a 4-4 minion, you don't have a way to deal with it except using Execute that early on. And I get a little nervous because the Unstable Ghoul means that its Death Rattle will pop the Egg. What do you think Snail's trying to achieve there right now?
I think it's a pretty underrated play. He recognizes the fact that at some point this game, he's going to have to deal with that Egg because at some point Sky High's going to have a buff for it. So he's just getting in some of that damage to just turn that Egg into a 4-4 early so that he doesn't have to. So that it's a little bit harder for Sky High to get value out of it, because if you manage to buff the Egg and then get a trade with it and then get a 4-4 and then get another trade, it's a lot of card advantage. So Snail's just trying to make sure that only the Nerubian is what Sky High is working with.
Yeah, I kind of like that attack, because on the other hand, how much does it accomplish to go face for one at this stage of the game? Nothing really.
A lot of times you win with board control from the Warrior side. The damage often can not really matter when it comes to 1 or 2 points, but of course, you know, as you start getting higher, it does. I like this attack too, to make the Egg, or sorry, make the Haunted Creeper and the Egg have to attack into the Ghoul if he chooses to buff it, and that way he doesn't have to activate the secret in case it's Avenge or Redemption. In this case, we do know it's Redemption.
Yeah, really tough turn for Sky High here. He wanted to have Keeper of Uldaman or Blessing of Kings. Truisil of Champion also would have been a fine draw, but all he has available to him right now is the Master for Battle and the Iron Beak Owl.
Yeah, he really wants to Owl this Unstable Ghoul, but he also wants to Owl the Acolyte at this point. It's definitely a tough call on how to navigate the turn.
If feel like card draw is the key, though, to how the Patron deck completely goes off. The more cards they draw, the more likely they can use a huge turn to get a bunch of Patrons in one go.
Yeah, it's also not too bad if the Ghoul goes off, you get the 4-4.
True. Yeah, there also could have been a Battle Rage, so in that case, Nail would have been drawing a lot of cards in any case. Mm-hmm.
Well, there is a lot of a potential to go aggressive here. You have Frothing Berserker and a ton of ways to stack its damage. There also is safe routes, though. You can go very conservative to try to remove the entire board.
Yeah, I would like to see Snail play Frothing Berserker there. And just get it up to a million power before that attack.
Yeah, this is really strange that he's attacking first. Because even if he's playing just the Armor Smith and not the Frothing, even in that case, it would be better to play the minion first, right?
I think so, but either way, he's only missing out on a few stats from his 3-drop, if that's what he decides to go with. He is working with perfect information now, having popped the secret, so no need to worry about that being avenged or anything like that anymore.
Yep, I guess he's just gonna go for the arm. Oh, he is playing the Frothing.
Okay.
Is there an upside to this, like not getting those attack buffs?
Big game hunter.
But I think Sky High's deck has pretty much been seen, so there's no big game coming up. But in any case, this Frothing is looking like it's going to get a lot of work done.
Well, there is a punish, I believe, on this. Because he didn't use Whirlwind,
oh, right, yeah.
The Keeper of Olduban allows it to be able to trade into it.
He can actually trade into it here.
Oh no, and all of a sudden, Snail had an opportunity to potentially just run away with the Frothing doing major damage.
Yep, this is really the reason that you kill off the Ruby and Egg and just give them the 4-4 in a lot of cases. Now it's going to get value twice.
15!
Abomination.
Yeah, that's all.
I mean,
that is certainly one way to describe that play.
A stable Ghoul, if it were to evolve, could probably be an abomination as its final stage, but
it's true.
Abomination. Maybe a miniature version of it.
Yeah, miniature abomination right there. Snail picks up a weapon here. Unfortunately, it's not the Death Spite, but Fire War Axe is still not too bad. I would expect him to also get the Armor Smith on the board.
The issue with the Patron deck is that most of your hands are very all-in a single strategy, whether that's like dropping a Patron or making a really big Frothing Berserker. Once your initial push is dealt with, you don't have much else going on. Like, Snail's hand is just going to be shredding water for a while Sky High develops massive minions. But at some point, he's going to drop that Tyrion, and the Warrior's just going to have no good way to deal with it. So for Snail, it was so key.
Yeah,
because that... To keep that... To keep the Berserker alive.
Yeah, absolutely. Would have gotten a couple turns maybe of attacking, and then all of a sudden you might be threatening with Grommash to end the game. Yep. Instead of Grommash might be your way to stay alive in two turns to use it as removal. I completely agree there, Raynad.
Yeah, mysterious challenger from the top. Sky High getting the blade on curve. Pulling three secrets out. Which one is gone? The one that's gone is Redemption.
Redemption.
Yeah, so the remaining secrets are going to be Noble Sacrifice, Redemption, and Avenge, all three of which will trigger here.
We haven't seen Competitive Spirit as well, so there is a possibility that Competitive Spirit would be the last secret.
Oh, yeah. So...
So it looks like it is Competitive Spirit. I think there is one more secret remaining. Snail can use Execute to stabilize some of the damage, which is very convenient. If it landed onto the Mysterious Challenger, he didn't have a direct way to activate the Execute without using Whirlwind or his weapon. But, you know, even though the Mysterious Challenger draw was very flashy, in the end, there's still, like, a big problem in the macro picture is the Patron Warrior doesn't have a direct way to seize back the board commandingly prior to Tyrion, like Raynad pointed out. And once Tyrion comes down, Tyrion is just like the king of value in so many ways. A lot of people look at him as the most powerful legendary in all of Hearthstone.
Yeah, Snail does have access to a Whirlwind, and he could potentially pick up a Battle Rage to go with that, but his life total is still above 30 even after he takes 7 damage. That's going to make that line of play a lot less effective.
Yeah, it's looking pretty bad. Armor Smith seems like the only thing he can really do here. He could go for an Inner Reach or Whirlwind, but the mana cost on those is so high, and they don't even accomplish anything, do they? He could attack with the Shredder into the Lotep, and with the Fiery War Axe into the Creeper, and use the Whirlwind. So that would only leave up the Mysterious Challenger. Mm-hmm.
This game really is a great way to showcase like how important all of these small early game attacks are. Because the difference between attacking face for 1 point of damage and attacking that Nerubian Egg for 1 point of damage led to Skyhigh being able to deal with that Berserker, and had that one point of damage just gone onto the Nerubian Egg, Snail would have had something like a 20-powered Frothing Berserker hitting Skyhigh in the face the turn after. So all the small decisions in Hearthstone really having long-term impacts that can really snowball out of control in the cases of decks like Patron.
It's oftentimes why people look at Patron as being one of the more intricate decks, you know, especially prior to the Warzone Commander change. A lot of people were saying that people weren't playing it correctly. You know, a lot of people feel like there's mistakes being made on a lot of people's ends just because it's so hard. There's so many small nuances. But in this case, Snail's line did not pay off, and now he's going to be on the receiving end of the Ashbringer. Well, it might not even need it, depending on how things go. Tyrion comes down, and there is no answer from Snail.
Yep, the Ash has been brought, but that Patron pickup actually
not a bad throw, I would say.
Yeah, you set up a massive board. Only two of the minions on Skyhigh's side can actually trade with it. So yeah, this could maybe give him a way to catch back up in the game. Maybe he does have a lot of life to play with, so maybe Skyhigh goes face instead of killing off patrons.
Sure.
And then Snail could pick up a Battle Rage.
That would be great. Battle Rage into more ways to synergize the patrons and get good trades. It's not over, but Snail, it has pretty much only one line here. Grommash is not really a reasonable play, I think.
I'm trying to think about it. Like, would it make any sense? Like, if you pop the Divine Shield from the Tyrion, you just drop the Grom and maybe not do anything more. But that certainly is weak to players like Keeper of Ulduman.
It is, not to mention that the Paladin can play with its life. So he can just use Weapon to remove and keep Lothiv up, and all of a sudden you gave up your entire board. He's going to have an entire turn to get initiative.
Right.
So it feels like not only are you wasting your own resources, but you're also setting yourself up to get overwhelmed by the board. This I can definitely get behind.
Yup. Snail's going to take his time, no reason to rush. Use his whole turn to think through all of his options and goes for the big Patron play. So let's see if that's enough to get him back into this game, because the situation is looking pretty dire before that pickup.
It sure is. And all Skyhigh, with that Blessing of Kings and a weapon, does have a way to get a full clear here.
Well, that Cockhammer is not too bad of a pickup either. Allows you to effectively start picking out these patrons. Because patrons on so little cards, I don't know if there's a need to rush the phase at all. Oh, I think you can take your time here and utilize this Cockhammer to just start beating down on some of these annoying dwarves.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. There's no sense of urgency here for Skyhigh. He doesn't really have any reason to try to kill his opponent quickly. He's still at 23 HP. After the board has been cleared, it's very hard for Snail to come back.
Snail's just going to opt to go ahead and trade out the Lothab. No reason to blessing that right away. And he might blessing after attacking, actually. Be on the creeper. Okay.
It's interesting. I guess prevent 2-1 from bumping into it. Mm-hmm. Well, Dread Corsair, not really going to do much.
Yeah, every single draw from the patron feels really underwhelming when you're so low on resources, you don't have much going on. It really is a deck where you go all in on this combo in the mid game, and if it works out, the deck looks super dominant, but then if it's not quite executed properly or the pieces don't come together, then you get a deck like this, which just feels so underwhelming. And it's a big part of the reason why even back when Warsong Commander, before the nerf, the deck was so popular on ladder because everyone, you know, claimed it was the best because it was at a high level and it was very cheap to build, so a lot of players tried it. But at the lower ranks, people aren't really having success with it. It's not as straightforward to pilot as something like Face Hunter or Zoo.
Yeah, completely.
Ooh, shots fired. But I do know what you're saying. And in this case, what can Snail really try to accomplish? He's just like going to be stalling the inevitable. Tyrion still has a lot of value right now just as a minion itself. And Snail plays it as a taunt. That's only going to temporarily stop the bleed. I think it's a Band-Aid on a missing arm.
Yep.
Yeah.
Iron Fur Grizzly, not quite enough against Tyrion here.
His beard is magnificent, though.
That's a nice
gotta
beard.
Admit it, as a pirate.
Wish I could grow facial hair, Dan.
Me too. As a strongly young adult Asian male, I wish I could grow facial hair and express my manliness as well. Until then, I'm just going to live vicariously through Hearthstone cards. I think Sky High doesn't really have... do you play both Muster for battles here just to load up on board pressure? I don't think like that.
I think just one is good here. Like, there's no room for the minions after all, so... Just hit for 11, get those dudes on the board.
Yeah, Patron Warrior does play one or two effects that deal one damage to the board, too.
Yeah.
I think he's going to probably opt to slam the Creeper. Really needs to... Try, I suppose it's Deathbite is what he's looking for at this point.
Yep. Inner Rage, not gonna do much here. Chromas is in the hand, so that's a nice combination, but there's those two taunts and a lot of other problems.
Yeah, even if you use Inner Rage to remove, it does. Like, Tyrion, the big threat about Tyrion is that even if you can remove off the board, there's still 15 damage when that weapon comes. So he's just gonna stall one more turn. But again, this is the point where you're asking the referee to stop the fight. It's like, somebody just stop it, because it's just the paladin's pounding mercilessly and the warrior hanging in there. But you know that there's just no really remaining shreds of hope here, unless Nail gets a miracle draw off the top of his deck.
What could that be?
Deathwing.
Even Deathwing. He's dead to Deathwing.
Oh, that's right.
Because the weapon comes out. I was waiting for maybe a surprise tech brawl or some kind, but not really sure that would even do it. It's going to wrap up game number two. Sky High is one game away from advancing first place in this group.
Yeah, that patron not working out at all for Snail. Two games in a row, he just hasn't been able to get the card draw going that the combo deck needs. Those battle rages for three cards, four cards, at least two cards are so important to get all the pieces together.
How about even drawing Battle Rage? Seems like it eluded him all game. Yeah.
I will say, I don't think that game came down to draws at all. I think that with the card Snail drew, he had the winning draw there. That missing that attack, I mean, it's the difference between your opponent having nothing and then hitting them for 20 in the face with Berserker, or getting absolutely wrecked like what we saw.
And the thing is, if the Keeper wasn't able to deal with that Thought of the Berserker, not only would it have been able to attack once, but maybe even twice, and the game would have been over on turn five or six.
Yeah, but that was a complex early game. Like, turn two through four, there were a lot of decisions about what to attack and how, mm-hmm. and he had to consider the secret that Sky High had. So that was a very easy misplay to make, I would say.
Sure. Well, yes, we have all the information right in front of us, and the secrets do play a huge mind game on what's going to be happening. So, again, game two is in the books, and we're going to get ready to game number three and see if Snail can turn around. But in the meantime, we're going to check out Al Sky High. He wants to win and makes his QQ discussion group really proud, so we got a chance to talk to him yesterday all about it.
My name is Al Sky High. I'm 21 years old now. Sky High is from a Japanese anime called Bunny and Tiger, and it's a character called Sky High. At first, I played Hearthstone casually, but after I joined the QQ group and meet those professional players, I started to play against them and beat them, and that gave me a lot of confidence to play competitively. A QQ discussion group is where the Chinese American players join together and communicate and practice together. In the discussion group for the winter preliminary, there is a guy helped me to prepare decks called BB Gang Gang, which really helps me to get qualified. So that gave me lots of confidence, and I think, yeah, I can do this. So I practice every day, and I do nothing except Hearthstone, actually. My family support me for playing this Hearthstone. When my father heard that I got qualified from the winter preliminary, he is so surprised. And you know, he is a very traditional person, and he even said, like, what game is this? I'm gonna download and play it too. In order to play against my opponent, I need to play perfectly this weekend because they are very strong and hard to make mistakes, so I have to be as better as I can to beat them. Winning this tournament is really important to me because in the 1,000 people QQ discussion group, they will be very proud of me. I'm all Sky High. I'm gonna win this tournament to make my QQ group proud.
Friendship in the QQ group. For people who are not familiar with QQ, it's Very similar to Skype. It's an online messenger system where they can message, and there's thousands and thousands of chat rooms that are dedicated to Hearthstone, and specifically with their practice group. It's just kind of funny to us, because in the West, QQ also is a way to express, you know, raging over a game. So in a lot of ways, it's very ironic. I actually happen to have a QQ group as well. I like to call it. Sometimes people call it Temple Storm.
Oh, Sky High.
He's caught off guard by that.
A little bit. But it's so hard.
Sorry, I'll cut you off. I was going to say, it's so hard to come up with comebacks when you have to be PG, you know?
I understand. It's a family show. So anyways, we've been having a lot of fun. Savitz, I was really interrupting you. Going to game number three here, what's the difference that Snail has to make going from this point forward? Is it just simply recognizing those opportunities, or is there something else that he can fix as well?
I mean, I think that confidence is a big thing, especially for him, because he has admitted that he has some issues with nerves. So maybe pick the mage first, because that's the best matchup, and try to like kind of get back into the game, get that first game first, and then go play the more difficult matchups afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's like one of the hardest things to recognize, and I think one of the biggest things that Snail has to do from this point forward is staying calm. I mean, Snail can recognize his misplay the moment it happened, right? He's like, oh, I lost his Frothing Berserker, I should have Whirlwind. He knows it. He's very much aware of it. And the easiest thing is to get sucked into it and start really doubting everything you do. You're not really confident in your plays, and all of a sudden, you're starting to become much more shaky. And it's a snowball compounding effect. I hope Snail can centralize and stabilize his mindset right now.
It is also worth pointing out, he's got three slightly favorable matchups for him against Druid, and we've seen Druid underperforming this tournament. I think TJ mentioned it had a record of something like 2-8 so far. So if there's any deck that can get reverse swept, it's Druid. It is a deck that's known for being able to beat anything with the right draw, but it can also lose to anything by having mediocre draws.
True. Yeah, exactly. Druid being the last deck, even though the score right now is 2-0 for Sky High, Snail is not out of it by any means. He can be able to take three games in a row with the lineup of decks that he has.
All right, here we go. Game three. Can Snail turn it around here? He needs to win from this point forward. Otherwise, Sky High will be the one moving in first place into the top four. Keep in mind, guys, these guys are playing for $25,000. First place prize also gets you a ticket to the Hearthstone World Championships guaranteed. So looking to see if these guys can make a splash, not just for the money and the pride, but also that spot.
Yeah, absolutely. So Snail started off by mulliganing away the Armorsmith, which is an interesting choice, because against Druid, a lot of times you want to get on board early, and really, like, every little minion that you can get to stick makes your Battle Rages a lot more threatening. It's very powerful, but I guess, why do you think he mulled that away, Savitz?
The Fiery Axe?
The Armorsmith.
Armorsmith. That's just more important cards, I suppose. Snail really wants to get the Deathspite Inner Rage Patron Flood as early as possible. That's my theory, because I think that's the most important thing. You really want to do the Patrons on turn 5, or at least on turn 6.
I definitely agree with that. Yeah, against Druid, that's definitely the best line of play. If you can get that three-card combo of Deathspite Inner Rage Patron or Deathspite Patron Whirlwind, and just develop that big board, there's nothing Druid can really do to counteract that. But yeah, he's got Shredder in his deck too. Interesting choice. I've seen some players choose to run Horcron Elite instead of that. But Shredder definitely the more resilient minion. I would argue better on turn 4, and Horcron being better later in the game.
Out of the combination of cards that was mentioned, he does have both the Deathspite and the Inner Rage right now. So the only thing missing is that Grim Patron. And with help from the Acolyte, unless it gets silenced, he's going to get multiple draws at it as well.
So I do have a question, if we can rewind our heads to turn one. Asgahai chose to keep his Living Root instead of play it out. What was he purposely trying to avoid there? Like a direct counter with a Whirlwind? Or is it like he didn't want to feed a certain minion with low attack, high health?
I think you're fine trading the Living Roots for a Whirlwind. He was probably more worried about something like an early Acolyte of Pain. I would have leaned towards maybe playing it, but he figures that it's more important to keep for later on. Maybe he wants to keep it for that Patron Flood to be able to take out the 3-2, or with an Azure Drake to kill out a full health Patron.
Yeah, Sky High also is aware that Snail's running in Stable Ghoul, Armorsmith. If he played that Roots turn one, he would know that Snail could follow up with that right away.
Yeah, Armorsmith also deals really well with those Roots, and it allows Snail to have a damaged minion on the board to help out with the Battle Rage.
Yeah, it's a really good point. And I think that might be like something that helps Sky High, because in the end, maybe he feels like he doesn't have the guarantee of getting a ton of damage in. because the patron will be looking to be much more aggressive than a control warrior who's usually taking a very defensive approach early on.
This is a super.
What do you think, Freyna?
I think that's a terrible play, Savice. That's what I think. I think he had the option to play either Shredder or Deathbite, two forward drops that are very clunky that he wants to develop as early as possible, and he opted to play the Unstable Ghoul instead, trying to get two cards off of Acolyte, which makes him vulnerable to Keeper of the Grove, right after Sky High just drew two cards.
I'm also extremely surprised by this, because he did have a good way to clear that Lord there. And the way I look at it is that if you have a Deathbite for turn four, you need to have a really, really good reason not to play it. And I don't think the reason was good enough in this instance, but it's going to be interesting to see if that extra card draw is going to pay off now.
Yeah, I mean, he'd definitely get a lot of mileage out of the Acolyte now that he's gone for this line of play. He can Interrage it, trade it in, play Deathbite, set up a Dread Corsair, which can, you know, deal with the Ancient of Lore. There's a lot he can still do with this draw. It's just unfortunate that the piloted Shredder is going to take a very long time to develop.
Yeah, and you know, I also agree, because like you said, Deathbite sets you up for whatever you potentially can draw as well. Like if you did pick up the Grim Patient, all of a sudden, then you have turns where you can go really far off and flood the board, and you have that Dread Corsair. Things like the Pilot Shredder too is, like you said, it's so important because Druid can't remove it very easily. It's not immune to that. Mm-hmm. The reason why Pilot Shredder is just so difficult to deal with is that after it dies, it still actually do stuff as well. And no. Snail,
I don't know what's going on.
Snail's pushing in for the Acolyte. I think he was maybe trying to draw for an execute, but still, this is one of these things where it's very confusing. To see what Snail's trying to do, because now he feeds the Sludge Belcher directly into an easy trade and gives free development for Al Sky High.
I mean, he had the opportunity there to develop a Deathbite, draw two cards, clear a minion off of Sky High's board, and develop a Dread Corsair to you know, trade with the Ancient Lore, but he opted to do this, and I really think what we're seeing is kind of just the pressure setting in for Snail. Yeah, he did mention,
I think so.
He was getting nervous, and you know, the momentum that Sky High's had in this series so far, getting off to a 2-0 lead, might definitely be weighing on Snail and just causing him to play a little bit differently than he would from home.
Yeah, I think in the end, what you start doing is what I was mentioning before. You start questioning everything. You start thinking, this is probably the real line of play that comes to my mind. But you start thinking, well, that's what I thought last time, and I kind of sabotaged myself. Should I be thinking of something else? And because you overthink it, you might end up costing yourself some really golden opportunities. Because like you said, these cards are still stuck in Snail's hand. He's coming up on even more awkward turns.
Yeah, that Deathbite really, it's such a powerful card. It kills two minions. The board is just getting worse and worse. And not only that, but he also has the Dread Corsair. I can't help feeling that the Deathbite should be on the board and instead of the hand right now. But also the Spiloted Shredder's, like, he had the option to play a Shredder on turn 4, and it's just, he didn't do it. Shredder is at its best when you play it on an early turn to get those efficient trades. Okay, finally the Deathbite is getting played. Let's see if it's too late.
I believe World Champion Oskaka was once saying, if you're not playing Deathbite on turn 4, you're doing it wrong. I'm not sure if it's a rule that applies every single time. It's, you know, one of those hyperboles to kind of emphasize your point, but with the Deathbite, it opens up a lot of other opportunities to make sure your minions are safer. In this case, develop the Dread Corsair to trade into things. I also like that really subtle move from Sky High. He chose not to attack into the 1-2 in case his opponent had some Whirlwind opportunities to really, like, shut the board down. And he didn't want to weaken it because he knew that the 1-2 still had to go through the taunt.
Yeah. Snail still has a way to kind of try to catch up on board here. Could have played an Armorsmith, an Inner Rage on his Slime, traded into the Lord, developed Dread Corsair. But once again, he's just going to let the Druid continue developing that board, and I really think this is just going to make him fall too far behind.
He's playing so slow with those cards, like really trying to maximize the value.
Slow is a word for it.
Yeah. I think slow definitely is the correct word. I think it's just a different mindset. He's playing as if he has like Control Warrior cards, like he has like Brawl in hand, but he really doesn't have any luxury of catching up on the board like this. What can he do? He might just die to the normal Force of Nature Savager at this point.
It really seems that every single turn that goes by, the board is getting worse and worse for him. But the issue is not even like drawing the answers to the board. It's just like, it's just trying to maximize the value. And here we can see that Battle Rage, and he will still have one mana available after drawing those three cards, so an execute could be played.
Also, we don't discount what could come out of the Shredder if he ends up whirlwinding.
That's right.
Might save him.
I've seen some crazy Doomsayer shenanigans happen. That could definitely help him recover.
Yep.
We'll see. I mean, Snail is going to go for this attack. I think he's debating which is the best to attack to position himself. The spell power on the Atrovic is pretty threatening, though.
I think Snail's debating whether he plays the Armorsmith first and gains the armor, or whether he goes for the Battle Rage afterwards and tries to draw into something like Execute or another Whirlwind, Inner Rage.
There it is.
Yeah, so he does go with the Battle Rage line of play, pays off. Let's see if he runs this Inner Rage out in the 4-1.
Nope.
He's just going to hold on to it. All right.
Now, I would have been kind of surprised if he did go for that, because we have seen it that he prefers to go for the value, so to say, with the plays that he's making with his patron.
And with one execute already being used off of a drawn card from Battle Rage, Dr. Boom seems like a much stronger play, even though you do want to draw ultimately to force Nature's Savage Roar. So ends up using the Boom and wrathing a minion for, I guess, 3 here just to press.
Yeah.
No need to draw a card. You have Ancient of Lore to draw more cards.
Yeah, it seems completely unnecessary here. Getting the extra 6 on the face. And Snail once again looking at a really, really rough board to deal with.
Well, when all else fails, there is the 1 in 80-something chance to try and get a Doomsayer to reset your opponent's board. What's scary is that you still might end up dying if your opponent has Force of Nature Savage Roar because of the Boom Bots.
Yeah, Snail does have the option here to turn his Shredder into a 6 attack minion using Inner Rage, running that into Dr. Boom and then playing a Whirlwind to clear off most of the board. He can even follow that up with some armor or Lothar.
2 Armorsmiths maybe, or 1 Armorsmith, and there's some plays here. The game is not over just yet. Sky High only holding under 1 combo piece right now, so the burst potential is not quite there yet.
Yeah, you're right. I actually really like that line, just because it keeps you the most defensive. And also, if the Boombots happen to have unfavorable outcomes, then you might actually be in a position to survive whatever comes out from the Druid next turn.
Looks like Snail agrees with us, and he's going to go for that exact play. Playing 2 Armorsmiths, getting that extra armor from the Inner Rage, from the attack. And here we go with the Whirlwind. Let's see what pops out of the Shredder on the other side.
There's a lot of outcomes that can happen. What comes out of the Shredder, how the Boombots land. It's not exactly the strongest minion. One Armorsmith bites the dust, though.
All right, well, Snail does have a lot of life to play with thanks to those Armorsmiths. And the Druid here, one of the issues with Druid is even if it doesn't have combo to end the game right away, it does in a lot of cases have an endless stream of threats. You play Ancient of Lore, you draw a bunch of stuff, you play Azurdrake, you draw more stuff, and you just constantly have a stream of threats until at some point you do draw that combo.
Yeah, this looks like a fairly easy Ancient of Lore here. He does have some other options, but I don't think anything else comes even close. All right, he's going to draw first. Let's see what he picks up. Is it maybe the Force of Nature? There it is.
Yeah, it's so interesting to see if Sky High ends up Wrathing or Hero Power here. I like this decision because holding on to that Wrath, Swipe, and Living Roots does give you a combination of spells to deal with any patron play that might happen in the future.
Yeah, that is a good point. Your opponent held so many cards. Maybe you're suspicious of what he's going to do. But the Living Roots being played aggressively, I guess that's just a read that he doesn't really think he has it anymore. He spent Inner Rage and Whirlwind to do it.
Snail pretty much dumped all the spells from his hand last turn, so now he's only stuck with those minions. It's hard to turn the board around with just those. Chroma's the only one with a charge and an immediate impact on the board.
His best play for tempo is these 2 cards with Lotheb and the Shredder. How much damage does exist right now on the board? Definitely not enough, but he's getting closer and closer.
Not quite yet. It would have been quite a bit. There was 9 power from the board, and the Roar would have been an additional 10 damage, but it's a little bit more, and it's nice to keep the Roar for the Force of Nature combo.
And next turn, he certainly has it with what's on board right now.
Oh, yeah.
So how does Snail respond here? I don't think he has even that many outs remaining.
Yeah, I mean, he might have to just run out the Gromosh here as an Execute Enabler, use the Piloted Shredder to either enable the Execute on the Druid of the Claw or use, you know, basically kill the Keeper plus the Druid of the Claw and just hope for the best. That's kind of the only line of play I'm seeing here. You could also go with maybe just a Dr. Boom and hoping that Sky High has no combo.
No, I think I like the Dr. Boom slightly more. Dr. Boom Execute armor up because, it would be more powerful with the Chrome right now and maybe save him from the combo, but
looks like he's dead, though.
All right.
Because he's at 25 health. And that should be exactly 25 damage.
That's 24.
Oh, 24.
24, yeah. Oops. He's one off this way. It's close, though.
Yeah, very, very close. My apologies.
Yep, Snail doing the math, realizing it's the line of play that lets him survive that combo. And Yeah, lives to play another turn, it looks like.
But, I mean, even though SkyHigh does not have the lethal here just yet, it's just a really dire straits for Snail.
Yeah, he still has a Swipe Wrath combination and take Grom off the board, even though he doesn't have Big Game Hunter. He's probably going to start by cycling that Wild Growth. Right now, SkyHigh is considering, okay, let me make sure I don't miss lethal. He did all the math over and over again for Force of Nature, Savage Roar. Considering, should I use Force of Nature to clear anything? Should I use this Wrath Swipe?
He can do both. He can use both those if he wants to clear. He can also just Wrath for better options. He still has cards like, you said, the Big Game Hunter to end it.
Draws for one. He's just going to use one Force of Nature to clear off the Chrom, it seems.
This is pretty reasonable as well. Because Force of Nature number two is hard to usually use in one turn. So just get the damage out successfully.
Very good sequencing there. Killing those first, getting that one damage on that three end. It's not a big deal, but still something that shows that he really knows what he's doing.
Snail is still alive, though, if he plays Boom and Hero Power. At least from what he sees. If his opponent has another way to innervate a single damage out, then it is pretty relevant. So we'll see if this can make or come back. Otherwise, SkyHigh has to play once again around some removal pieces.
Yep, SkyHigh's threatening of combo is keeping Snail from developing and dropping Berserker here.
He's just going for it. Makes sense, too, because he has Swipe in the hand, so he can just direct damage it next turn, saying, I'm going to put you on check, and if you can't answer, then I win.
That's a really heads-up play from SkyHigh, and he does it without hesitation. It's a really impressive play, to be honest, because he's aware that, you know, both Armorsmiths can play.
Exactly.
Right? So there aren't too many other common armor sources in the Patron deck. He doesn't play things like Shield Block or Shield Maiden or Justicar that we see in other Warrior decks.
Yeah, in case that the Armorsmiths were not played, that might have been a little bit questionable because there was that chance that Snail could have healed himself outside of the Swipe range in combination with that Hero Power, but now that there is no Armorsmith or anything like that, it looks like this series is over. SkyHigh is going to take it with that Swipe.
Yeah, great series play from SkyHigh. Snail definitely not going his way, but it's not over for him either. However, we do have a winner in Group B. The player who took down his hero and now taking down the Tavern hero. SkyHigh is going to be advancing to the top four alongside Nub.
Yeah, really commanding performance from SkyHigh. Just really comfortable with his deck, solid play throughout. And yeah, a definitely deserved victory there.
Yeah, I think so too. Snail may be a little bit shaky on that Patron at some point. Like in that last match, maybe he could have played it a little bit more aggressively, trying to get those minions on the board, playing the Dead Spite earlier. There were small things that he could have done differently, for
sure. Yeah, I mean, when you get 3-0'd as Patron, it's a little bit tough, you know, a tough pill to swallow at that stage. So not exactly feeling comfortable for Snail, but again, he's going to be playing tomorrow in the Decider match to see if he can advance over whoever wins in the lower match of Group B. In the meantime, SkyHigh guaranteed top four, one step closer. How do you think of his play overall? Because we're focusing a lot on Snail and what he could have done, and it's easier for us because he's on the lower POV. You know, what do you guys think of his play that series right now?
I was kind of surprised with the pacing of the play. A lot of turns, he would really take his time and decide what he wants to do, but then some of the less intuitive plays he would make very quickly, which is very surprising. So definitely one of those players that's taken advantage of his opponent's turn to think through his plays, and that's a sign of a really good player.
Savitz, closing thoughts?
Yeah, I think he played really well, and he definitely deserved to win that series. That Warlock deck with those deck cards, Ooze, Harrison, Kazan, interesting to see how it works going forward from here.
Playing for his QQ group and one step closer to claiming the America Championship. Al SkyHigh is waiting with Rob for a few words.
Thank you, Dan. I'm sitting here with SkyHigh, or standing rather. Congratulations on winning the series. You beat Snail 3-0. Very commanding series. Did you expect it to be that easy?
Not actually. I think I just because my strategy works out really well. I also have very few turns of Gold Rush with the Paladin deck. Sure. Yeah.
All right, so you've now beaten Bill, a good friend of yours. You've beaten Snail. You're in the top four. You are just a few matches away from claiming a spot at the Hearthstone World Championship at BlizzCon later this year. What would it mean to you to be able to go to the Hearthstone World Championship?
For me, like, I'm actually deciding if I want to be a pro Hearthstone player or not. So winning this one is really important to me, like help me decide whether I'm going to do next.
Right, so you mentioned in your interview that you were friends with a lot of players in a group called the QQ Discussion Group, and you know you wanted to make them proud, and they had to be extremely proud of you for you to have made it this far, have this much success. Do you have anything you want to say to them at home?
Yeah, of course. Can I speak with Chinese?
Yeah.
你们看我屌不屌啊? Yeah, that's it.
All right, thank you, Sky High. Congratulations. We look forward to seeing more from you tomorrow. But for now, we're going to go ahead and toss it over to TJ and Soddle over at the sidebar.
Thank you very much, Rob. Welcome once again to the sidebar. I'm joined by Soddle. A really interesting series there, and we saw a lot of patron play. Snail actually lost all three games with patron. So first off, just talk to me a little bit about what you think of Patron Warrior in the current tournament meta.
Sure, it's not bad. I actually expected to see a lot more of it in this tournament than we are. Very powerful against Druid, which we've seen every single player is bringing into this lineup. Paladin and Zoo and two other strong matchups, considered two of the most popular decks in the meta right now as well. So it's pretty well placed, and I certainly expected to see a lot more of it, but people are going Control Warrior.
Yeah, and it really struggled in this match. And we want to highlight a few plays that were made by Snail in some of the earlier turns of this matchup. So let's get right into our first screenshot and break this one down. So this was a play that Snail had made earlier on in the matchup. So let's go ahead and roll this clip and see exactly what he does, the decision that he makes. Soddle, why don't you walk us through this?
Right, so you can see the Unstable Ghoul getting played here, which is pretty much the nuts early against Secret Paladin. It's so frustrating for them to deal with, and their minions like Haunted Creeper, Must of a Battle, just don't interact particularly well with it. But what he does there, which is kind of a mistake, is chooses to nudge the egg and put it down to one health. And you'll see as the game rolls on, that puts him in a pretty awkward position later.
Yeah, so let's see a clip that's a couple of turns later in the match where his decision to attack into that egg really came out to fruition. And there's a couple of things here that are a little bit questionable. So why don't you go ahead and point those out, Soddle?
Yeah, so first off, you see the repercussions of the egg being at one health because it kind of messes up his whirlwinds, which would help buff his Frothing Berserker. He'd end up with a 4-4 on the board. He'd need to execute, etc. Secondly, he does a bunch of actions before playing the Frothing Berserker, leaving it only as a 2-4 on the board instead of the huge minion it could have been. So, you know, you can say Patron struggled in this series. I'd have to go ahead and say that Snail kind of struggled in this series more than the deck did.
Yeah, and it's important to plan out, and there's an argument that he may not have known what the secret was, but there was a couple that he had checked for, and it just seemed like he wasn't planning out his turns ahead, and he was just sort of playing his hand as it came to him instead of, you know, planning out his turns, which is necessary with Patron.
Yeah, absolutely. And not only just not planning out his individual turns, he wasn't showing too much forward planning. You know, poking that egg down to one health with an Unstable Ghoul on board just didn't really make a great deal of sense. And it's kind of strange because he did the same thing with a Haunted Creeper on a following turn, which was actually really smart.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
He made the mistake of doing it early with the egg, and you see that it just cost him going into that turn.
Yeah, really rough performance. And Warrior's been one of the most successful decks over the course of the last 2 days, but it's been majority control. So Snail will have another opportunity. Tomorrow he will play in his decider match for his group. So he's not out of it yet. He's probably going to go back, really think about those matches and see. But a big congratulations to Sky High for moving on. But we are going to get into the next match in just a few moments. But while we wait for that, check out some highlights from that last match.